We've been together for a while now. We're growing stronger every day now. It feels so good and there is no doubt I will stay with you. As each morning brings a sunrise and the flowers bloom in springtime, on my loving you can rely, and I'll stay with you. There'll be heartaches and pain, yes it will, but through it all we will remain. Hey, in this life we all know, friends may come and they may go, but through the years I know I will stay. Yes, I will. Oh, I'm gonna stay when no one else is around. And when the dark clouds arrive, I will stay by your side. And I know we'll be alright. I will stay with you. Yeah, everything will be fine. Yeah, and I'll stay with you through the end of all time. I will stay with you. Ooh, 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 ooh.
Hey, welcome to Grace. My name is Wayne Murray, if we haven't met, and I'm glad you're here today. Aren't you excited for daylight savings time? Right. I would like to highly encourage you to not make up for the hour you lost during church. Let's do that this afternoon. I think the topic today will help keep you awake. Today, we are finishing our series called Stronger, and our message today is how to be sexcessful. Yes, that's a play on words. Now, we're going to deal with this topic appropriately, but openly. Okay, and so I think it's highly appropriate for middle school and high school students. However, elementary age students, I think every parent has the right and deserves the right to dictate and lead that conversation. So if there's any doubt in your mind, I encourage you to take the opportunity to have your kids be part of our Kids of Grace Children's Church service. I know Pastor Ryan and Amber would love to have them, okay? And you'll have a couple minutes. I've got some preliminary things to say to get them there and get back, and you won't miss much, okay? Has anybody enjoyed these past 5 weeks learning about Stronger? Yeah? Good. Great. We've seen a lot of new faces over the last few weeks, and we are glad you're here. I hope when this series is over that you'll continue to come and be part of our services. One of the things that we offer for people who are new to help get connected to our church is the Growth Track, and that's going to take place this afternoon, 2 to 4. There's information in your bulletin. And by the way, this is the last time we're going to offer Growth Track on Sunday afternoon, because after that, it's going to go to Sunday mornings, okay? So encourage everyone to be part of Growth Track this afternoon. You don't have to register. We have childcare provided, so go ahead and join us, okay? Everybody say okay. Let's do a little bit of a review. The ushers are passing out their notes. I want to encourage everybody to take a copy of the message notes, especially teenagers. Take a copy of those notes. I want you to take notes today. I think everybody's going to be encouraged and learn a lot. But let's review a little bit what we have talked about in Stronger. We started out talking about the fact that we are all broken because of sin. Sin entered the world in the Garden of Eden and brought with it shame and blame and guilt. And that's why there's no such thing as a perfect family. Even the first one wasn't perfect. And thank God for the grace of God. Amen? All the perfect parents said amen. Oh, wow, there's a few. Okay, go back and watch that message, all right? And then, over the last 3 weeks, we talked about what it means to be a stronger man, stronger woman, stronger parents and kids. And the main lesson I hope that we've all taken away is, if we're going to have stronger relationships with one another, We have to have a strong relationship with Jesus. It's when we become Christ-like that our relationships grow stronger. When we learn to be like Jesus and lay our lives down for the people in our lives, that's when strength comes, okay? So that's what we've been talking about. And the same principle is going to apply today when we talk about this particular subject, being Christ-like. Now, I have a few goals for today's message. The first goal of today's message is I want to paint a picture of God's best when it comes to sex. God's best for all of us, married, unmarried, but particularly for students and young adults. I want to paint a picture of God's best for you because God wants best for you, and we, the people who love you, want God's best for you. And then the second goal is to have a biblical understanding of sexuality. Our culture does not have a biblical understanding of sexuality. We need to think correctly about sex so we can behave correctly about sex, right? And it's the truth that exposes deception. So that's what we're going to do here today. Here's our third goal. My third goal is I want to empower people with a past to embrace the grace of God. Now, I'm going to share a lot of things here today, and it's going to apply to everybody, but it's going to apply to everybody at some different level. But I know that some are here, and your past includes some sexual sin. I've got some very good news for you. You are in a church called Grace, Assembly of God. It's not just a name. It's our testimony. It's who we are. And so we believe in the power of God's grace. If you believe that, say amen. All right, so let's pray. Would you pray with me? Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place today to speak to us. We need to hear your voice. We want to hear your voice. And God, we pray today that your truth would expose Satan's lies. And God, I pray especially for men and women, especially students, especially young adults, God, would you give us a vision for what you want for us? May we hear and experience your heart today. Let your will be done. Let there be clarity in the spiritual atmosphere. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So let's start with this question. Perhaps a question you've never been asked in church before. Who is having the best sex? You can go ahead and get your nervous laughter out. It's okay. Who is having the best sex? Now, if you were to believe what's on the magazines at the grocery store and what's on TV and what you hear in music, you would say one thing, but how many know there's perception and there's reality? There are wagon loads of evidence that I'm going to show you that say these people are the ones who are having the best sex. Are you ready to find out who they are? Married people who waited to have sex till they were married, they were virgins, have been married a while, and are religious. And the religious thing is a little bit deceiving because it's specifically Christians, followers of Jesus. Study, you're in a good place today is what I'm saying. Study after study says this is true. Now, I want to show that to you. I've got all kinds of research to show you here. Professor Dean Busby of Brigham Young University surveyed thousands of married people ranging in age from 19 to 71 years old. They were married from less than 6 months or more than 20 years. And here's what he found. The couples who waited until after marriage to have sex rate their sex life better. So if you wait to have sex until you're married, it'll be better. They reported that their marriages were more stable and satisfying, and their communication was better than the couples who had not waited. Things that make you go, hmm. Here's Robert Rector and Kirk Johnson from the Heritage Foundation. Women 30 years or older who had just one lifetime sexual partner, their husband, had a divorce rate of only 20%. Pretty powerful stuff. The University of Chicago conducted the most comprehensive study of American sexual behavior, and it was reported on by Tucker Carlson of that great theological bastion, MSNBC. And the title of the report was, "Why Are Christians Having Better Sex Than the Rest of Us?" It says, this is the University of Chicago, having a religious affiliation was associated with higher rates of sexual success for women. The devout are actually having better sex than the rest of us. Who'd have thunk it? According to the National Health and Social Life Survey, people who go to church regularly enjoy their sex partner more. 84% of people who attend religious services weekly gave their partner high marks. And people who attend church infrequently, less than once a month, rated their sex lives the worst. Perhaps we should rethink our church marketing strategy. There's another report. I'm sorry. Hey, I got to get the laughter out, right? There's another report, Sex in America, a definitive survey. Sexual survey after survey have shown that the people who report having the best sex are, wait for it, married, conservative, Protestants. Wow. Which pretty much means that everything, television, music, media, magazines, newspapers, and what's reported about sex is wrong. If this research is true and study after study, survey after survey says this is true, that means that pretty much everything that we're hearing on a daily basis about sex is a lie. It's not true at all. One report says that 90% of all sexual relationships on television are outside of marriage. And let's be honest, sex outside of marriage or before marriage is portrayed to be normal, is portrayed to be the best option. And the sexual lives of married people who are committed to one another, they are portrayed as boring, not exciting at all. You say, what's going on here? Well, let me tell you what's going on here. The Bible says that the thief, which is Satan, comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. The enemy hates you. He hates me. He hates marriage. I'm going to tell you a little bit that he hates sex. And the reality is, we need to think correctly about this. We need to know the truth so that we can live free lives. Amen? So I've got just a couple things to share with you about sex here today. Here's the first one. God created sex. What a novel thought. Who made this thing anyway? Well, God did. It was his idea. Matter of fact, there's an entire book in the Bible about sex. And it's pretty explicit. It's called the Song of Solomon, which is also titled by some the Song of Songs, which means the first song ever written about sex was written by God. Pretty amazing stuff, right? Now, if anyone says that sex is bad or dirty in itself, how many know we have the entire Bible to contradict that? Because God doesn't have a low view of sex. He has a high view of sex because he created it. Look at this in Genesis chapter 1. God said, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness." So men are made in the image of God. Women are made in the image of God. God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, being a man, being a woman, is God's idea. If you were born with the right parts, that's who you are. That's what God created. God blessed them and said to them, "Be fruitful," which means, go ahead, "and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it." God saw all that he had made, including our sexuality, and called it what? Very good. God created sex. Since God created it, it's good. Now, just like everything else, everything that God created is good for us when we obey God. And so we need to understand that God created sex for marriage. In Genesis chapter 2, here it is again, a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Now let's talk about this for a moment, because that word united literally means to cleave or to adhere to. Now, between services, Pastor Gary was telling me that one of the applications of this word is like double-sided tape. Pretty amazing, but when the illustration I'm going to show you in just a little bit. And they become one flesh. Now, what does being a man being united to his wife, what is the Bible talking about? Sexual intercourse. Sex makes a man and a woman one. It takes two people and makes them one flesh. So God created sex, think about it, to be like glue for a relationship between a man and a woman. And marriage then becomes a union between two people so profound, the Bible says they become one single person, a single unit. That's pretty powerful stuff. So The Meaning of Marriage is a book written by Tim and Kathy Keller. I highly recommend it. Here's what they say. This covenant brings every aspect of two persons' lives together. They essentially merge into a single, legal, social, economic unit. They lose much of their independence. In love, they donate themselves wholly to the other. Now, doesn't that sound like Jesus? Isn't that what Jesus did for us? He gave himself for us. And that's what the Bible says that marriage is like. And so, listen, sex is more than just a physical act, right? We're not just animals. There's something different that happens in us when a man and a woman have sex. There is a chemical and spiritual bond created. Some call this enmeshment. Some call it soul ties. But did you know that one of the chemicals released in your body during sex is oxytocin? Now, oxytocin is a neuropeptide most commonly associated with pregnancy in women and breastfeeding. And it's released also when a woman breastfeeds her baby. And so God created that hormone, obviously, to connect the baby with his or her mom. It's called the super glue of sex. It's the super glue that connects people together. Dr. Joel McElhaney is founder of the Medical Institute for Sexual Health. He says this bonding during sex is real. And almost like the adhesive effect of glue, a powerful connection that cannot be undone without great emotional pain. So is it any wonder then that according to the Bible, sex equals marriage? Sex equals marriage. It's the same thing. In the biblical understanding, there is nothing else, or there should be nothing else. See, Pastor, what are you talking about? Well, if you've been reading the one-year Bible a few weeks ago, you're reading through Exodus, and remember what this one of the laws was in Exodus 22. If a man seduces a virgin who is not engaged to anyone and has sex with her, he must pay the customary bride price and what? You got to marry her. In the Bible, having sex with somebody is the same as marrying somebody. It's that big of an issue. It's that serious of an issue. So if a man and a woman have sex, they are stuck together. Matter of fact, God designed it that way to help a married man and a married woman stick together, which is why in Song of Solomon, the scripture says, I am my lover's and my lover is mine. Sex is supposed to be exclusive between a man and a wife. He created love to be exclusive love. So the Bible says don't unite with somebody physically unless you're also willing to unite with that person emotionally, personally, socially, economically, and legally. So when am I ready to have sex? When you are ready to say I do. when you are ready to give it all to somebody else, when you are ready to no longer be your own person, but to completely give yourself away and become one flesh. It's so serious that Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians 6. He says, "Do you not know that a person who is united in intimacy with a prostitute is one body with her? For as it is said, the two shall become one flesh." He's talking about the power of sex to bring people together. "Keep away then from sexual immorality," or sex outside of marriage. "For you do not belong to yourselves. You were bought with a price. Show forth God's glory then in how you live your bodily life." That's a pretty sober warning, isn't it? Paul's talking to a very corrupt sexual culture in that time in 1 Corinthians. And he's saying, guys, listen, you can't just go have sex with anybody you want, because whoever you have sex with, you are stuck to. So flee sexual immorality. Everything about sex is designed by God to cement two people together. Are you getting this? And that's why God intended marriage and sex in marriage to be between a man and a woman for a lifetime. And God's brilliant in this way to help men and women stay together. Having sex helps people stay married. Would you like me to address a little bit more of that? I'll get to that in just a minute, okay? So listen to this. God created sex. Why did God create sex? Think about this. And we have to step out of our perverted culture to even get this. Listen closely. When a couple engages in sexual intercourse in marriage, think about, you have man created in the image of God. You have a woman created in the image of God. But when they are joined together, you have the full image of God coming together. And that brings glory to God. Listen closely. Is it any wonder then, and here's my second point, Satan hates that. Satan hates sex. Now, I know if that were the title of today's message, there'll be a lot of people saying, "Oh, Pastor, you must not be paying attention." Listen closely. He hates sex because he hates you. And he hates God. And he hates the image of God in you. And he hates marriage specifically, right? God, it makes sense then that he would take this most incredible gift of sex that God created for marriage and corrupt it and counterfeit it and demean it, right? Now remember, Satan's goal for us always is to tempt us to think that we're smarter than God, that we know better than God knows. Isn't that the way it went down in the Garden of Eden in the very first original sin? Did God really say, "Well, you know, if you eat that fruit, your eyes are going to be open and you're going to be like God, and God's trying to keep you from that"? Isn't that basically how it went down? It's the same way with sex. God says, "Here's a gift, here's an incredible gift, a blessing that's unlike anything else." But Satan says, "You know what? God created you sexually. He created you with urges and instincts and desires. Why would you repress that? God must be wanting to control you. God must be wanting to repress you. It's your body. It's your decision. Do what you want with whomever you want, whenever you want." But you got to remember, the Bible calls him a thief. And what he wants to do is steal from you. Let me say it this way. Satan's goal is to trick you. Instead of having something real, he wants you to embrace something counterfeit. Instead of embracing the best that God has, he wants you to embrace something empty, something that is faked. Are you listening closely? Because how many would agree, there is a world of difference between premarital sex and sex inside of marriage. It's way different. The research is showing that. One person illustrated it this way. Premarital sex, or sex outside of marriage, because it's forbidden, it's kind of like the way we've illustrated many times on our platform, a flash of fire. It's like, boom, a flash powder, gunpowder, whoo, you know, it goes. You feel the heat, the intensity of it, but then it's gone. There's nothing left. There's a memory of the experience, but there's nothing of substance. Versus married sex is you still have the fire, you still have the passion, but it's built on the firewood of trust and commitment and the coals of sacrifice. And so that flame keeps on burning. Come on, somebody. And it grows. And the more you feed it, and the more you tend the fire, the hotter the fire grows. All the married people say, never, don't say anything. That's what you should say. God's way is the best way. God's plan is the best plan. So when God gives us guidelines about sex, he's wanting us to be sexcessful. He's wanting us to be fruitful. He's not trying to ruin your fun. He's not trying to repress your instinct. He's not trying to keep you from joy or pleasure. Matter of fact, it's the exact opposite. He's trying to set you up to be blessed. Remember the scripture in Jeremiah 29? I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to give you a future and a hope. I'm not trying to harm you. I'm not trying to hurt you. Listen closely. I know this is complete opposite of our culture. You Christians, a bunch of prudes, you know, God's this. No. It's a lie. God is being misrepresented. God's the one who created sex. Satan is the one who hates sex. So let's talk about how do I be successful? What does the Bible say about sex so that I can experience God's best for my life? Now, these may be the most profound spiritual points I've ever made. I'm being sarcastic because here's the first one. If you want to be successful, have sex if you're married. Have sex if you're married. Somebody's clapping. Praise God. Now, it's a good time to drink water. Now, remember all the research I showed you at the beginning? Who's having the best sex? Married people. Married people who have been married a while. Why? Because God designed them to. That's the way our bodies work. Now, Tim and Kathy Keller, in their book, look at what they said. A marriage covenant is necessary for sex. And sex is also necessary for the maintenance of the covenant. So, there's more to marriage than sex. Absolutely. We get that. And some people, let's just be honest, some people just have it out of balance. Let me talk to some of you guys. You are ate up with sex. You need to get some balance in your life, okay? Because our culture is so, we're so crazy about this idea. We need to get some balance. There's more to marriage than sex. But sex is part of marriage, and that's why God created it. And since the Bible confines sex to marriage, we should probably not be very surprised that in the scripture, we find the commands for men and women who are married to have sex. Pastor, where's that in the Bible? Let me show you. 1 Corinthians 7. The husband should fulfill his marital duty to his wife, and likewise the wife to her husband. The wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. In the same way, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. Do not deprive each other except by mutual consent and for a time. And what's Paul saying here? Paul is saying that sex wasn't just created by God for procreation, it was also created by God for recreation for married people. So he says, don't deprive one another. Okay? Now, let's take a time out for a second, and I want you to be amazed by what Paul is saying here, because the Apostle Paul wrote these words to a sex-crazed culture. The Corinthians were crazy about sex, prostitution, all kinds of sexual morality. But I want you to notice, in the time that Paul wrote this in the first century, it was the norm for men to have sex with their wives so they could have heirs and babies, and then have sex with whomever else they wanted for pleasure. Women were treated as property. Right? And so women couldn't do that, but men could do that. Look at what Paul says. It's very revolutionary. He says, guys, the husband's body does not belong to him alone, but also to his wife. He's saying this whole, you know, going around and just sleeping with whoever you want, you can't do that. Your body belongs to one another. He says don't deprive one another. The cultural context of the statement is astonishing. No one had ever said that before. Pretty powerful stuff. And this passage indicates that sexual activity for married couples should be frequent and reciprocal. Now, I know what you want me to do. You want me to define frequent. And I wasn't born yesterday. So, I'm not going to do that for you. Everybody's definition of frequent is different, okay? But remember this. I think this is so important. And this is where our relationship with God should have a dramatic effect on every area of our lives, including this area. So listen closely. Sex is not something that you take. Sex is something that you give. Are you getting this? Lust takes. Love gives. I'm preaching now. Sex is perhaps the most powerful God-created way to help you give yourself to another human being. So it's this thing that God has created to help us, listen, give ourselves away, to give. Now, as always, when we obey God's word, who benefits? We do. When we do what God says, who gets the benefit? We all do. So there are some benefits, married men and women, of having sex. Let me share a few with you. Having sex an average of 3 times a week is the equivalent to running 80 miles a year. Put away the stair climber. This is the part you can laugh, and I hope you do. Sex increases good hormone production, improves muscle tone, and loads your system with good cholesterol. When a married woman and a married man experience sex with each other, endorphins are released, also known as nature's aspirin, which helps alleviate the aches and pains of a body. So the next time, guys, she says, I have a headache. It's science! I feel danger. I'm going to keep going. Sex for women aids in memory retention. So next time she says, I forgot something, never mind. I'm going to keep going, all right? It reduces the risk of prostate cancer. It lessens the incidences of colds and flus. It burns calories. And according to a 1997 study in the British Medical Journal, men with the most active sex lives have a death rate half that of those who are least active sexually. So sex prolongs your life, which gives new meaning to the phrase, you're killing me. Sex has been shown to enhance posture, alleviate depression, anxiety, insomnia, helps digestion, bladder control, and dental health. It's healthy for you. So in the words of Nike, just do it. That's what I said. This is not even a marriage retreat. Can you believe that? One person illustrated sex in marriage to be like oil in an engine. How many know without oil, an engine, the friction between all the moving parts will burn out the motor? And in a marriage relationship, there's some friction. All the married breathing people said amen. There's friction. And so without sex, it can bring about anger, resentment, and disappointment. So matter of fact, Pastor Ed Young wrote a book. Actually, he preached a sermon series a few years ago in his church called Sexperiment. And in this series of messages, I'm only brave enough to preach one Sunday. He did it for like 6 weeks. And he gave a challenge to all of the married people in his church to have sex at least once a day for 7 consecutive days. How's that for an altar call? He wrote a book about it, which, by the way, we have for sale in the hub on your way out today. You can pick it up there. We partnered with Family Christian Stores. There's lots of resources that you can pick up there. But they created a video to help promote this challenge, and I'm pretty sure you'll want to see this. I apologize. You'll never be able to play ping pong the same ever again. That might be right up there with the nail in the head for the women. I mean, I'm not sure. So if you want to be successful and you're married, have sex. If you want to be successful and you're not married, don't have sex. I studied for hours to come up with this stuff. If you want to be successful, listen, it's for your benefit, if you're not married, to not have sex. So what does sex outside of marriage, what does that include? So some of you are waiting for a list, so here goes. Pornography. Hooking up with your fiance or boyfriend or girlfriend. Oral sex, phone sex, cyber sex, sexting with anybody you're not married to. Living with somebody you're not married to and having sex with them. Having an affair, committing adultery. Getting a no-fault divorce because you want someone new or you're tired of who you're married to. The Bible gives some very strong warnings about this because of the power that God has created in it for married people. Look at the warnings. In 1 Corinthians 6, flee sexual morality. Let's stop right there. Notice Paul doesn't say avoid sexual morality. Try not to hang around it. Do your best not to. No. He says run from it. Run for your life from sexual morality. Don't mess with it. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. The research is catching up with the Bible. This was written 2,000 years ago, but the research is showing that our sexual revolution is damaging our bodies and damaging our ability to have sex. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Hebrews puts it this way. Hebrews 13:4, marriage should be honored by all and the marriage bed kept pure, for God will judge the adulterer and all the sexually immoral. Does God take this seriously? Absolutely. Ephesians 5, but among you, there must not even be a hint of sexual morality. Don't joke about it. Don't flirt with it. Don't watch it. Don't be part of it. Not even a hint of sexual morality. It's that dangerous. The Bible is saying to unmarried people, do whatever it takes to keep yourselves from sinning sexually. Whatever it takes. Now, older cultures used to take this more seriously than ours. And I've got an illustration from a movie, The Patriot, that will show a little bit how they took care of this problem in the past. Watch this.
Oh, nearly finished.
You needn't worry, Father.
Yeah, I know.
Oh, I think bundling bags are a wonderful tradition. I don't mind in the least. Oh!
Still. Tea?
Please.
Come, dear. I'm pleased that you like it.
Any parents like to see bundling bags come back into style? Parents know that we would do whatever it takes to protect our kids in this area, right? It's that serious. Now, why does the Bible give repeated warning after warning about sexual sin? Look at what Tim and Kathy Keller have to say about it. The Bible doesn't counsel sexual abstinence before marriage because it has such a low view of sex, but because it has a lofty one. The biblical view implies sex outside of marriage is not just morally wrong, but personally harmful. Remember, the scripture before says a person who sins sexually sins against his own body. It's harmful. How harmful is it? Well, in the book of Proverbs, you probably read, as you're reading the one-year Bible, how many times the writer warns, don't give in to sexual morality, don't give in to the adulteress. And then one particular verse says, he did not realize it would cost him his life. All sex outside of marriage leads to death. Listen closely. Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm not just talking about physical death. Although that's very possible through STDs and AIDS, but I'm also talking about emotional destruction, relational destruction, mental and spiritual destruction. All sex outside of marriage is destructive. This includes pornography. Dr. Marianne Layden, in her testimony to the United States Senate, called pornography a toxin that damages viewers, their spouses, and their children, creating a miseducation about sex and relationships. And look at what she says. This is her testimony to the Senate. She says, pornography damages the sexual performance of those who view it and will eventually reduce their ability to have sex. Another study says, sexual arousal and excitement diminish with repeated exposure to sexual scenes. It's hurting you. It's destroying you. So the Bible is right. Amen? According to the American Academy of Matrimonial Lawyers, 2/3 of the 350 divorce lawyers say the internet played a significant role in divorces in the past year, with excessive interest in porn contributing to more than half the cases. Listen closely. The University of Iowa study said that those who are sexually active early in their adolescence, specifically before age 16, are more likely to divorce. Listen, students, why should you not get involved sexually? Why should you guard your sexuality? Because the earlier you get involved sexually, the more likely you'll get divorced when you get married. The same study says up to 47% of women who lost their virginity during their teen years divorced within 10 years of getting married, implying that women who lose their virginity during adolescence will inevitably face conflict in their later adult relationships. You're not going to see this on television. You're not going to hear this in music. Everything our culture is telling you, be sexual, let it all hang out, do whatever you want, get involved. But the Word of God and the research backs it up to say, if you do that, you are signing up for a lifetime of heartache and trouble and unneeded pain. You remember the glue analogy we were talking about earlier, that word united? Studies show that if a woman has multiple sexual partners, let's read it. This is what it says. People who have misused their sexual faculty and become bonded to multiple persons will diminish the power of oxytocin, that hormone that bonds people together, that super glue. It will diminish the power of oxytocin to maintain a permanent bond with an individual. That's serious business. It's kind of like this. Sex is like this moving tape in this box. You know, if you take this tape and you apply it to this box, you know, this tape and this box, they're bound together. They're committed to one another. And if you don't move the tape, if you don't pull the tape off, it will last for who knows how long, centuries maybe. But what happens if you take that same tape and it was glued to a person, but you pull it off? Something's left, a part of that person. Well, okay, I'm attached myself to somebody else. Now, it might stick. But it doesn't have the same adhesive power. And what happens if we go from one partner to the other? One partner to the other. Pretty soon, it doesn't stick at all. God's plan is one man, one woman, for a lifetime. Ironically, Kellers say in their book, ironically, sex outside of marriage eventually works backwards, making you less able to commit to and trust another person. We can begin to see why God warns us so repeatedly to flee sexual immorality. It's harmful. It will damage us. And the degree of damage people receive largely depends on the degree to which people become sexually active before getting married. So let me strongly encourage and warn students and young adults who are not yet married. This is serious stuff. And remember that God loves you. God's plan is the best plan. So you have to take seriously this issue of protecting yourself sexually. Now, I know the lie is that, you know, oh, just one time, or one time doesn't matter. But do you know that when you have sex, there is a drug that is released in your hormones called dopamine? It's like a narcotic. And you can become addicted to it. The same with pornography. And if we allow ourselves to become involved, oh, we're not harming anybody, you're becoming addicted. So don't believe the lie and protect yourself. Matter of fact, you should do what the scripture says in Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 7. The lady in Song of Solomon says, daughters of Jerusalem, let love sleep until the time is right. Don't wake it up. Let it sleep, daughters of Jerusalem. Let it sleep, sons of grace, until it's time. Until you're ready to stick with somebody in marriage for the rest of your life. Are you getting this? How many students and young adults believe I'm telling you the truth? How many of you believe that God loves you and God wants what's best for you? Now, I know there are some here today, and your story involves sexual sin. What about me, Pastor? Are you saying that I'm broken? Are you saying that there's no hope for us? Is there any grace or hope for those who have made mistakes? Can a person who has been damaged by sexual relationships outside of marriage have a meaningful sex life in marriage? What do you think? Answer is yes. It's because of the grace of God. But let's be honest, it'll be much more difficult. Can I shoot straight with you? Yes, you can have a meaningful sex life in marriage, but it'll just be more challenging than those who didn't. So we can paint a great picture for our students and for our young adults and those who are unmarried, all the while understanding that God doesn't throw us away when we sin. Matter of fact, I would bet anybody here that your testimony is being forgiven and being restored of sexual sin. You would be the one screaming the loudest, protect yourself. I believe that. Matter of fact, many people were sharing that with me after the service. They said, Pastor, thank God. Thank you for addressing this. Thank you for saying, listen, there is grace. God gives grace. And I was praying hard today about today's service and really all this week as we were preparing for this, because I don't want the enemy to use a good thing as a tool to beat you over the head. Because the Bible says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So nobody should leave this place thinking God hates me, God doesn't love me. No, 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 no. There are a whole lot of people in the Bible that committed sexual sin and God restored them. Read Psalm 51, read about David's prayer, and you'll see that God does restore. He paid a price, but God restores. How many believe that the grace of God even covers this area of sexual sin? Amen? If you're here today and you're married and your marriage has sustained an injury involving a sexual sin, there's a ministry that we're affiliated with in our church called Marriages Restored. And I highly, highly recommend that you take advantage of that. On your way out at the Next Steps kiosk, there's some information about when the next one's going to take place. If you know somebody that's marriage has been injured through sexual sin, make sure they're part of it as well, because we serve a God who heals. We serve a God who restores. Amen? And so let's believe God for that here today. So let's pray. I'd like to pray for three different groups of people here today, and I'm not going to ask anybody to stand, and I'm not going to ask anybody to raise your hand, so go ahead and just breathe a sigh of relief. You know, I'm not going to ask the most sinful people to stand and come to the front. We're not going to do that. But I would like you to bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm going to pray for three groups of people. And the first group of people I want to pray for today are students and young adults and the not yet married. The students, the young adults, and the not yet married. And parents and grandparents, I know you're going to want to join me in praying for them. So God, we pray for these young men, these young women in our midst, those who are watching online. God, would you give them a vision for their future? Give them a vision. Give them a vision to have courage to reject what the culture says and to obey you and to do what you ask. Holy Spirit, we ask you to raise up a generation of young men and young women who love purity, who love righteousness, who are zealous for the kingdom of God, for the word of God. And I pray, God, you would, God, just give them a picture of how powerful their lives will be if they'll do what you ask, if they'll simply believe your word. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. I'd like to pray for all the married people here today. If you're married and you're sitting near that person you're married to, I want you to take them by the hand. If they're not near you, I just want you to join with them in spirit right now. And Lord, we just pray for all the married people here today. God, the covenant that they have made with one another is holy. And so God, we pray that you would help the men and the women in this church who are married to one another to be faithful. Faithful to one another to the very end. Help us, oh God, to honor our commitments, to honor you as we honor our spouses. And God, we pray that we would reflect the glory of God in our marriages. May we reflect the kindness of God, the image of God in the way we interact. And Lord, help us to lay our lives down for one another as a witness and a testimony of giving our lives to Jesus Christ. I pray, God, for the married people in this room who are experiencing challenges and difficulties. I pray, Lord, that you would drive the enemy far from them and help them, oh God, embrace the grace of God, that your blessing rests upon their household and their family. And I want to pray for those that are perhaps older, maybe you're divorced, perhaps you're widowed, perhaps you've never been married, I don't know. Maybe you're praying for a spouse, you're asking God for a spouse. I want to pray for you today because I know this is a unique message for you, but it applies to everybody. So God, I pray for these men and women among us. Perhaps they're single, perhaps they're divorced or widowed or widowers. I pray that your grace would surround them and strengthen them. May you use them as a model to others of what it means to put you first in their lives. God, I pray for their hearts. I pray, God, that you would become the absolute number one priority in their lives, and trust that as they seek you first in the kingdom of God, everything else will be added to them as they believe you, God. We give our hearts to you. We trust you, Lord, in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Are you glad for the word of God today? Have you learned anything during this series? Praise God for that. Praise the Lord. There's a lot more resources at the table. I highly recommend Brian Dollar's book, Talk Now and Later, How Parents Can Talk to Their Kids About Sex. We don't have a book at the table, but it's listed on your notes as a resource. A Chicken's Guide to Talking Turkey to Your Kids About Sex by Dr. Kevin Lehman. It's awesome, so check it out. Take this seriously, parents. Take the lead in this conversation. Amen? Praise God.